Because it was NASA's radio telescopes tracking NASA's spacecraft, it was essentially the metaphoric equivalent to the fox guarding the hen house.
Notice the picture. It's Parkes Observatory. Although Jarrah acknowledges NASA's tracking stations at Goldstone and Madrid, he avoids mention of Canberra in his Exhibit D series. Instead, he shows Parkes Observatory and says it was NASA's tracking telescopes, yada yada. His statement is misleading at best.
The major flaw in this claim is the fact that Parkes was not owned or operated by NASA. It was owned by the Australian government. The Carnegie Corporation and Rockefeller Foundation together funded half the construction costs of the radio telescope, and the Australian government paid for the rest. Since it began operations in 1961, it has always been owned and operated by Australia's government body for scientific research, CSIRO, the Commonwealth Scientific and Industrial Research Organization. Jarrah knows that.
Firstly, we in Australia pronounce it CSIRO, not CSIRO.
It's not pronounced CSIRO, Jarrah. It's spelled CSIRO. It's an acronym. In the States, we usually pronounce acronyms as if they were words. I do thank you, Jarrah, for pointing out that, unlike lazy Americans, Australians typically spell out acronyms and don't pronounce this particular acronym, CSIRO, as CSIRO. If you really want to get nitpicky about verbalizing acronyms, then why not start pronouncing NASA as the NASA?
Secondly, the CSIRO has been involved with and funded by NASA since the early 1960s. On the CSIRO's website, we learn that...
Notice that the title of this article clearly describes the relationship between CSIRO and NASA as a partnership? Yes, NASA contracts out work to CSIRO, but other customers or partners to CSIRO do as well. Also, notice how Jarrah conveniently zooms in so the word partnership is not visible while he reads the article.
CSIRO manages the Canberra Deep Space Communications Complex, one of three stations around the world used for communicating with NASA's spacecraft under contract to NASA.
Hallelujah, he finally said the name. Canberra. Not Parkes, not Australia, not the Australian Radio Telescopes, but Canberra. The third leg in NASA's Deep Space Network Triple Crown, and practically in Jarrah's backyard. Regardless of Jarrah's previous nonsense, lumping all of Australia's radio telescopes into one because they were all working together on the same project, we have finally cut to the chase. There should be no more doubt in Jarrah's little mind as to which of Australia's radio telescopes are actually owned by NASA. He just told us. The Canberra Deep Space Network Complex. Those are the stations with the NASA signs out front. Remember? Thank you, Jarrah, for setting the record straight for us once and for all. I couldn't have done it better myself. Honestly.
Since the early 1960s, NASA has also contracted CSIRO radio telescopes to augment its network of tracking stations for particular missions.
The operative word in this statement is contracted. NASA contracted for time on the CSIRO-owned radio telescopes and paid for it, just like every other paying customer or partner to CSIRO would do.
The first such occasion occurred in 1962, when CSIRO's 64-meter Parkes New South Wales Australia telescope was used to receive signals from the Mariner 2 spacecraft. It was used again in 1965 to track Mariner 4.
And NASA was so impressed by Parkes that it became the model for all the big antennas at Goldstone, Canberra, and Madrid, which, incidentally, make up NASA's Deep Space Network.
And further down below, more recently, NASA has contracted with CSIRO to use the Australian Telescope Compact Array near Narrabri, New South Wales, for future space missions.
Parkes is owned by CSIRO and is currently operated by the Australia Telescope National Facility, ATNF, a division of CSIRO, and is part of the constellation of radio telescopes, including the Compact Array near Narrabri and the MOPR Observatory near Coonabarabran.
NASA has contributed to changes to CSIRO's telescope that benefit both space tracking and astronomy. With so much contribution and contract funding coming their way of NASA, we can expect Parkes and the CSIRO to remain cooperative for some time yet.
No doubt they will remain cooperative in the future, Jarrah. This article talks about a partnership between two companies. That's all. Nothing in this article even suggests that CSIRO would lie for NASA.
Clearly, whether owned by NASA or the CSIRO, Parkes was clearly directly working for NASA during the Apollo days. It was Station 23 of NASA's manned spaceflight network. So much for being independent verification.
Clearly, whether NASA contracted Parkes to support Apollo or any other missions, Parkes Observatory is still owned by CSIRO, not by NASA. That does necessarily make it an independent, non-NASA facility. By the way, tracking stations didn't have to be part of NASA's deep space network to be part of MSFN, or the Manned Spaceflight Network. We'll cover that when we get back to critiquing his Exhibit D series.
That pretty much wraps up Webb's video. The video has not even been officially released yet, but clearly, the premise of the video is false. It is one part straw man and six parts fallacy of omission.
There was no straw man. Jarrah's rhetoric could give anyone the impression that he said Parkes relayed all the moonwalk videos, plural, to the world. And I don't know what he considers my six fallacies of omission. None of the three I've covered in my rebuttal had anything to do with Parkes.
It is most important to note that a lot of the things already addressed in this video were touched in my response to Phil Webb's introductory video response. I uploaded that video on May 9, and records show that Webb commented on that video on the very next day. The release date of his Parkes video is May 21. Given the fact that he commented on it and added it to his favorites, he had to have watched the video. This means he uploaded his video knowing full well that its content is false.
A lot of things were addressed in his response to my introductory response? Oh boy. Maybe I need to go back and actually watch his fallacies video. Nah. The only thing I recall him really complaining about in his conspirators video was my not catching his pseudo-confession regarding Goldstone. No problem. I'll fix that in my Parkes video before it goes public. Everything else is still fair game. I do apologize, though, for not being able to sit through Jarrah's fallacies video for much more than a minute. It's too bad that Jarrah stole an unlisted video and made blind, misleading accusations about me without any verification whatsoever. Jarrah would have been better off if he had just waited to catch me with my pants down after I released the video publicly. Fortunately for me, Jarrah suffers from premature articulation.
Phil Webb is outright lying to his audiences, and there are more videos on the way.
Debunk Webb's Parkes video. That's one job taken care of. Next.
Ooh, the gloves are off. Phil Webb is outright lying to his audiences? Not from an unlisted video, I'm not. Sorry, if the only thing Jarrah can accuse me of is misrepresenting something he said in one video, then changed later on in another video, that's not lying. It's utter confusion. As I have pointed out before, Jarrah makes so many incongruous, conflicting claims that it's impossible for a mere human to keep them all straight. So, at this point, I promise again not to watch any more of Jarrah's video responses until I get my entire series posted. Now, if you will excuse me, I've got a Parkes video to update. Ciao, moon hoax conspirators. Wherever you are.